Hey, kids, you're listening to a couple of annoyed grunt boys, and this is the 138th Simpsons podcast. That's right, we're the Simpsons podcast that discusses the beloved animated sitcom The Simpsons from seasons 11 and beyond, and the newest episodes when they air. Why do we do it this way? Well, an entity known as Wheel of Random has trapped us and cursed us to only watch those episodes, because plenty of other podcasts out there have discussed the glorious age, that being seasons 1 through 10, so we're tasked to find if any of the newer episodes can match those classic Golden Age episodes. But I don't do this alone, but I'm just one half a host named Craig. The other half a host and annoyed grump boy is...
Steve. Hello, Craig.
I'm going to confuse our listeners because slowly and surely our episodes have been dropping on YouTube, like going down. So like we were at that time saying half a host.
Mm-hmm.
We weren't annoyed grump boy. So that's why I'm stuck in my head. It's like, I'm half a host, Craig. That's how we used to do this podcast, remember?
All those years ago. Yeah, back in the simpler days of 2020.
Yeah. Hey, I'm Craig. That's how I talked back then, right?
Mm-hmm.
I know we're not a political podcast, but I need to bring something up politically real quick.
Oh, no.
It's the primaries in America where for the 2024 election, so we get our... So if you have like mail-in ballots like we do in the state, I got my primary ballot the other day and, you know, to vote for whichever Republican or Democrat that I want to represent. I don't get to choose both sides. There's only one side.
Right.
This is where I'm going to talk about this real quick. At this point, it's kind of silly. I feel like it's really silly to do this because we already know who's going to be the Democrat and Republican nominees in this country. But as you're filling it out, you have to fill one column, one Democrat or one Republican, right? And so if you fill one on each, your vote is null and void in this primary. I don't know how it's done in other states, but this is how they do it in this state, right?
Right.
But after that, you have to sign the envelope, you know, their name and date it. Also on the envelope, it says, I hereby declare I'm a Democrat or I hereby declare I'm a Republican, right?
Mm-hmm.
And this is on the outside of the envelope. And I just feel like that's a little too much, right? Shouldn't that like be when the auditor gets it, when they open it, and then it says inside the envelope? I'm not saying like my postal workers are disgruntled or political in any way.
Mm-hmm.
But I feel like if there was a Postal Service employee that saw that and said, oh, this person is the political party that I'm not affiliated with, well, oops, that went away. Like, that's not getting checked out, you know?
Yeah.
Not getting processed.
Huh.
I don't know how they do where you are, Steve, but in my state, that's how it is.
Yeah, so I am in Oregon, which is one of the pioneers in mail-in voting, and we have a similar thing where you can vote in the primaries and with your registered party and not the other, but it does not say your political party on the outside. In fact, you vote, you put your envelope or you put your ballot in the envelope and then you put it in another envelope that's a privacy envelope. So you can't see anything, not even your name or that it's signed.
Right.
Yeah, I totally agree with you that that seems to like invite malfeasance because regardless of who you're voting for, Craig, I know who you're voting for.
Our listeners, of course.
Yeah. But
RFK Jr.
That's right. He's got the racks and he doesn't have the vax. He's going to win. Yeah, that seems like a suspect or sus, as the kid said 5 years ago, that I don't think I like that. It seems sketchy and invites trouble. And we don't want that in our elections because it's not really a thing, but it could be.
Right. Because in Washington, I think it's where... I don't know if you're registered, like you're registered at the time of voting, like right now, primary. It's like, okay, so if you registered as the Democrat or Republican, then it's in the file, like, okay, so this person is Republican or Democrat. But then next cycle comes around, you like switch parties.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not like, I think in Oregon, you declare what you are. So when you get the primaries, you're only getting the option to vote for if you're a Democrat.
Yeah.
But in Washington, you have the option to switch parties at any given cycle.
See, even that seems a little suspect to me because one could, in theory, vote for a lesser candidate for their opposing party in the hopes of getting them nominated and then switch parties and then vote for your preferred candidate in your party, right?
Look, I'll just say, you know, I'm a dude. And I just think Nikki Haley's kind of hot. So, of course, I'm going to vote for the hot one.
I mean, yeah, if you can't vote for your with your dick, then what are you doing?
Yeah. Come on, man. Vote with your dick. That Vote with your dick, Nikki Haley 2024.
Now, that's a t-shirt.
It's kind of like my, like, you know, there's a new Curb, your enthusiasm going on. So every time, like, I'm watching a new episode of Curb, I'm thinking, like, you know, as all, like, white men at over the age of 30 all identify with Larry because we all are Larry David.
Mm-hmm.
You're not a special person if you think you identify with Larry David. We're all Larry David, okay, people?
Right. He but thinks you get those... you're not supposed to think, and that's why you're really with him. Yeah.
Yes. We all do this. But that's my whole, like, thing I'm watching. I'm like, but that seems weird. Like, if my mail carrier is just like, fuck these people who vote this way. So either side, that's what I'm saying. It's like, right, doesn't matter. But I don't like the idea of that information being out there. In fact, there was an auditor that ran this last year who was a very MAGA type person,
mm-hmm,
with the funny name of Bert Simpson. No, it was Brett Simpson. I'm sorry, I'm throwing his name, it doesn't matter. His name was Brett Simpson.
That's really funny.
But he was a big MAGA dude. And if he would have won, I'm sure voter fraud, mail-in voter fraud would have happened with him, mm-hmm, in control. Again, not a political podcast. This was just my observation, my Larry David moment, my Curb moment, if you will.
Yeah, I appreciate you fair sharing.
All right. So I'm not the only one who thinks it's weird. You thought it was weird since we vote in different states. But, totally. Yeah. Tell us how you're voting by email us at 13simpsons@gmail.com. No, don't tell us anything about that. Just get out there and vote. All right.
Rock
now we got that out of the way. Yeah, cut that out of the way, Steve. Let's get on with this week's episode. We're going to be going back to the year 2010. That's when you and I were in preschool at that time, right?
That sounds about right, because we're, what, 20 now? So yeah, that makes sense.
This was like 14 years ago. Yeah. We were just cum then.
Aren't we just cum now?
Do you think there's any listeners of this podcast that were cum during this episode? Okay. I said that they were cum during this episode, but now they're 14 and listening to us.
You know, I look at our demographics from time to time, and we do have like 2-3% of people who are like under 18, so it's possible.
Hey, if you're a cum baby, let us know at Instagram at 13simpsons.
Why does that sound so offensive? Like, I mean, I know it is, but like, cum baby just sounds so gross.
It should be like, what I meant, like, when we review an episode, you were just cum at the time.
Right.
Like, we were never cum baby Simpsons, because we were already children by the time the Simpsons aired.
Right.
But, like, your wife was a cum baby.
I don't really like that.
Your wife was born in 89, right?
Yes.
Yeah. She would have been baby. She was never a cum baby during The Simpsons.
Right.
Because the first episode was December 89.
Right. So she was at least 10 months old.
A couple months old. Yeah. Okay. So you're fine.
Yeah. I mean, maybe during the Tracy Ullman short, she was.
Well, right. Yeah. Yeah.
I don't even want to say it.
No, she wouldn't have been cum by 87. She wasn't even in existence yet.
Right.
She was like, if you believe in reincarnation, she was already like, she was someone dying in 87.
Uh-huh.
Steve, look up who died in 1987 celebrities-wise, and that's who your wife was. Did Vincent Price die in 87? Maybe your wife is Vincent Price.
She is pretty creepy. She does love painting eggs. That's a very obscure Simpsons reference from some Super Bowl episode.
I literally type in celebrity deaths 1987. Hey, Rita Hayworth, maybe.
Hey.
Rita Hayworth. Liberace? I mean, she married you, and Liberace would have loved to marry you.
Same with Bob Fosse.
Andy Warhol, Fred Astaire, Jackie Gleason.
Danny fucking K.
Lauren Green?
Hey.
Man. Hey, the second doctor, Patrick Troughton. Look, Steve, your wife could be a lot of these famous people, but I'm going to stick with, like, out of your wife. I think she's Andy Warhol.
Yeah.
Okay.
She likes soup.
Actually, no, I'm sticking with Liberace. Your wife's past life was Liberace.
I'll take it.
Wait, what does your wife think about the movie Shawshank Redemption?
I don't know if that, that might be Laura hasn't seen.
All right, well, make her watch that, because if she likes it, then she is Rita Hayworth.
Okay.
Just tell everyone, you know, like, you know, my wife used to be Rita Hayworth. Okay. Steve and our cum babies, we're going back to 2010, April 18th. Steve, what was the number one movie in the box office?
Oh, well, we were all taking names because We all just kick some ass because the number one movie in the box office was, in fact, Kick-Ass.
One of those superhero movies?
Yeah. But luckily, in this day and age, we don't have to worry about those anymore.
I like the Kick-Ass.
Yeah,
it's a fun movie.
Yeah.
And the sequel.
It was Jim Carrey and others?
James Austin Green. What's his name? The guy that plays Kick-Ass? James? I think he's a three-name guy.
Yeah.
Aaron Tyler Johnson. I think that's his name.
Yeah, that sounds about right.
He's got a huge hog. Did you know that?
I did not. Good to know. Well, Craig, we were just amazed by how big his hog was. What were you listening to?
I'll say I probably was listening to this. The Billboard Hot 100 was Rude Boy by Rihanna.
Good song.
The hot rock alternative was Between the Lions from STP.
Oh,
Stone Temple Pilots. Yeah, what was it, 1992?
Yeah, like, was Scott Weiland still alive back then?
No, he's dead. He's dead.
He did.
The country was not Beyonce at this time, Steve. No, it was Texas Highway 20 Ride by the Zac Brown Band. What is this, 1992? And then the hot electric dance song was Scream and Shout by Britney Spears and Will I Am. Didn't we just have this one? Britney Spears and Will I Am song? Yeah, okay. All wonderful, wonderful songs. Well, Steve, should we just get on with this week's episode?
Indeed.
It's called Chief of Hearts. Homer is close to completing his court-ordered community service when he befriends Chief Clancy Wiggum by offering him one of his sandwiches. And a partnership blossoms, but Homer doesn't come through when Wiggum needs him the most.
Oh, no.
All right, Steve, I think we need to take a little breaky-poo, come back and discuss the episode. We'll get in with this week's episode. That's what we do, right?
That's right. Sounds great.
Okay, we'll be right back, folks.
You both jive. You hear me? You both jive.
And we're back. Today we're talking about Chief of Hearts, the 18th episode of the 21st season, originally aired April 18th, 2010. It's episode 459 in the show's run. Your nerd code is MABF09, written by Carol Omine and William Wright, directed by Chris Clements, and the showrunner is Al Jean.
Carol Omine. We know Carol.
Not personally.
Not personally, but we've talked about her quite a bit. So she's written a number of episodes that we've reviewed. Little Big Mom, Great Money Caper, Strong Arms of the Maw, A Star is Torn, Dell In for Nerder, our first episode, Working Mom, Highway to Well, Way of the Dog, My Octopus and a Teacher, and Mid-Childhood's Night Dream. And, you know, this episode was co-written with William Wright, who has written three episodes of The Simpsons, two with Carolyn Omine, this one and our first episode, Dell In for Nerder, as well as Season 26's Blazed and Confused, which we have yet to review.
Steve, it's Omine A, not Omine, Omine A.
Oh, man. Carolyn Omine.
Yes. Yeah. Look, just think of, are Canadians mean A? No, of course not.
No. Omine A? There we go.
Have we even talked about the co-writer ever, William Wright?
No, we haven't. I don't think we've ever even mentioned his name, which is kind of shitty of us.
He also co-wrote the first episode with Caroline. And then this one, he also co-wrote with Blazed and Confused. If you Google his name, there's probably like 5,000 William Wrights that come up, right? It's probably going to be too hard to find. The first one is the actor William Wright, who died in 1949 at age 38. So, hey, at least we could say we lived longer than William Wright. There's a
Willie accomplished something.
Yeah. There's a botanist with that name. There's a football player. I just think it's too hard to find this William Wright. Oh, we have a William Wright obituary. He died in 2023 in Portland, Oregon here.
How did he do it?
Yeah. But I don't think that's the same William Wright.
No, it wasn't. I assure you.
It's just this is like an older man, see, that born in 1930, died in 2023. I don't think that was you. It doesn't say anything about murdered.
Okay, yeah, because it shouldn't.
There's William.
Why it would.
Yeah, Wright Photography. So maybe William Wright he's not real.
Yeah.
I think if, like, Caroline makes an error in, like, Simpsons lore or a joke that should be cancelable, she's just like, it wasn't me, it was William who wrote that one.
Mm-hmm.
You know, for instance, this podcast, you know, no one's ever seen us, right?
No.
It's just one person and we're doing two voices.
That's right.
We're really, like, semi-talented Frank Caliendo.
Yeah, we're like that the radio guy.
Howard Stern?
Yes. I got it. What's his name?
Tom Likas?
Yes.
All right, folks. Honk your horns and flash your titties. That's a reference to Tom Likas. If you grew up in, I guess, was he mostly West Coast? Anyways, it doesn't matter.
Yeah. They a horrible person.
Phil Hendry. That's who you're thinking.
That's
Phil
what
Hendry.
I'm thinking of. Yes, there it is. Thank you.
Yes, we're the modern Phil Hendry. Mm-hmm. I wish. Okay, Steve, enough jibber-jabber about these wonderful people?
I think so.
Okay, well, let's begin our episode, Steve. It's nice to see a, you know, this is episode's, what, it's 14 years old by the time we're recording this. But
that's crazy.
Seems due to us, but we get like a full opening credits, like the 3-hour version. We have the Snyder cut of Simpsons credits, pretty much. You have a title gag of King and Kodos, and they're flying by, and they're unidentified flying objects. Are they really unidentified? Because I can identify those as the King and Kodos ship, so I don't think they're UFOs.
It is just a flying saucer, and we know it. We've identified it. So
yeah,
it's an FO.
It sure is.
Next, we have a billboard gag of C. Montgomery Burns standing in front of a American flag with the words, "Death and taxes, two things I avoid."
This must have been a nice little call to people making sure to get their taxes in at time. April 19th is when this aired, so you had the week before to get them in. Yeah, 2010, I think that was the last time I did my taxes. I think I'm due for this year, right? You have to do them like every 14 years. Is that what it's supposed to be?
Yeah, it's like the consensus, but less strict. So yeah, you should be.
Oh, okay.
You can probably wait till next year too. I think 15 is a nice round number.
All right. Well, I usually write a letter to say, "Dear IRS," and I stuff in like some loose change and some dollar bills that I found. Like, here's my taxes. Love, Craig. And then stamp it and throw it in the mail. I think that's good, right?
Yeah, I think that's totally fine. I like to tape mine up in the shape of a football. Throw it in there at midnight. It's great.
Hey, chalkboard gag. This counts as gym and art class. Look, I think I agree with Bart on this one.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, when I was in high school, I was in the band. So we had marching band, you know, the beginning of the year and the end of the year. And that counted as gym. So I didn't have to take gym class. So
nice.
You were pissed about that, weren't you? You wanted, you were like, "God damn it, I should have joined the band."
Yeah, I was in journalism. And there's like no real physical activity there.
Yeah, journalism, yeah, it doesn't count as gym or art.
Not even an art form anymore. I'm gonna write a blog.
Did you ever have
a podcast?
Yeah, did you ever have like a fedora with a little press thing on in the brim or anything?
Yeah, and I would say
it's crazy. You did it.
Yeah,
hey, Mister,
hey, Mister,
you got the latest scoop?
Then they would be like, "Get out of this, Baskin Robbins."
Is there a cash gag?
There sure is, and it's a big one. At a fine dining establishment, a 4-course meal is served. First is a salad in the shape of Homer's head, which is eaten by a mysterious diner. Next, there is a bowl of soup in the image of Lisa's head, and I like to think that it's miso soup because I think Lisa would enjoy miso soup. It's vegetarian, after all.
Hmm.
The soup is slurped up, and the next course is served spaghetti and meatballs, or should I say Marge balls, because it's in the shape of Marge's face and iconic beehive hair. The entree is next. It's a ribeye steak in the likeness of Bart's head with the bone working as his eye. So after the steak is consumed, the plate is taken away and the dinner is given a check, a very reasonable total of $49.62, along with a peppermint in the shape of Maggie. A hand of the diner takes the mint and we see that the hand belongs to one Jeff Albertson, better known as the comic book guy. He wipes his mouth with the cloth napkin and throws it on the table, making an image of the Simpsons sitting on the couch, because this is a couch gag after all.
Uh-huh.
And comic book guy lets out a sigh and says, "Terrible."
Well, looking at the bill, Steve, we have soup for $4.95. That now looks like a bowl of soup, so I guess that's okay. Garden salad, $3.95, sure. Spaghetti, $12.99. I just feel like, no, we'll get to that later, but ribeye, $23.95, and at modern day prices, that's pretty good. This is actually kind of spendy for 2010.
Maybe, yeah.
But, soup and salad and spaghetti with steak.
Yeah, that's what I think is weird, is having spaghetti and steak. That's just, I'm not opposed to it, but it's just not something you would do.
Yeah. So if the ribeye looks like Bart, I guess I would eat that face.
I mean, you already had his shorts.
Yeah. Look, they're already like 3D printing, or the process of 3D printing like fake meat, like steak, to make it taste like steak. So I think in the future, like, we could possibly 3D print a Bart steak.
That's pretty cool.
I feel like we've seen this before, though, this couch gag.
So it has shown up once before in Wedding for Disaster, the 15th episode of season 20.
Did we do that? We haven't?
No.
So then maybe I've just seen this on my own. Oh my God, Steve, I've seen an episode without this podcast. I'm sorry.
Whoa. I feel cheated on, frankly.
Funny thing is, this episode that we're reviewing now, I think I just watched it about 2 days ago on FXX. So
weird.
Yeah, so I'm like, I watched this already. But that means I'm ahead of the game, right?
Yeah, yeah. You're doing your research.
I have a little trivia at top, though. Steve, did you know that? Noticed anything a little off in this episode, maybe like character-wise?
Yeah, it seemed like somebody was missing.
That's right. Gil Gunderson wasn't in this episode.
I was going to say, where's good old Gil?
But also, Lisa, the character Lisa Simpson, one more episode that she was also not in was called the Moho House, which I don't think we've reviewed that either. Mm-mm. But yeah, no Lisa. Do you think it's because she doesn't like the idea of... Homer having a friend?
Yeah, she wants her daddy to not be friends with anybody.
Maybe she also hates games that kids play.
She didn't like the gambling aspect of Battle Balls. And also, I think all the parm talk was a little too meaty for her.
Actually, I'm going through some documents that were just handed to me. Nope. Apparently, Yardley stole Caroline's Danish.
Oh,
and so she got revenge by like not putting Yardley in this episode. Because the Danish. Yeah.
That would upset me too.
At least it's not as bad as like the office ladies who would steal a Danish and then put laxatives in it and then give it back to the writers so they had diarrhea all day. I mean, that's allegedly from what I've heard from the set. So
yeah, but I'm sure that happened to Ryan Coe, so.
All right. Steve, our episode begins, as it always does, with Marge driving the kids to a birthday party for a kid they don't even know. So Marge is sure Bart remembers Dylan, since they were in Toddle Tots together. But Bart says that he doesn't even remember if Dylan is a boy or girl, but when Marge assures him that he does, she also realizes that she's unsure of Dylan's gender. So she checks the invitation for clues, but finds that it's a underwater fish theme. And that doesn't offer any clues, right? Boys, girls, all genders love fish.
Yeah, just ask Troy McClure.
I remember when you were about this age, you sent... me a invitation to your 10th birthday, and it was fish theme, but it wasn't like the sea ocean fish. It was Abe Vigoda, the TV show Fish.
Exactly. That's the exact kind of party that would happen when I was 10 years old.
Your dad dressed up like Barney Miller and yeah.
You could be Wojo.
Yeah. We had to recreate episodes. I've said it before. I mean, you'd probably have to get rights to it, but if you wanted to just do a stage play, just take an old script of Fish. Or of Barney Miller, because you don't go anywhere. You stay on one set. Mm-hmm. It's easy for you guys to stage crew. It's all stage show.
It is. That's what makes it so great. It's all encaptured in one place.
Is that when, like, Cheers... I don't think Cheers ever, for me, ever jumped the shark. Mm-hmm. But when Cheers, like... Because the first couple seasons, they never leave the bar.
Right.
And then, like, all of a sudden they do. It's like, we're going to Norm's house or Frasier's house.
Yeah, like, if they went to Gary's Old Time Tavern, that felt okay, because they're still, like, in barland.
Yeah.
But yeah, if they went somewhere else, like you say, somebody's house, that felt weird and wrong.
Except for, you know, the classic Thanksgiving episode, when they do go to Norm's house, it's great.
Yeah.
And also, I think the one of the best two-part Cheers episode is when, is it Woody and Kelly's wedding? And it's like a two-parter, and the whole episode just takes place in the kitchen of the Gaines estate, Kelly's
parents. Oh, yeah,
that's
a great episode.
And that is a stage production right there, because it's 40 minutes. All right, Steve, we're going to do a Cheers in the Park this summer production of that. People will be mad because the episode doesn't take place at the bar itself. We'll just call it, like, the wedding, a Cheers story. That way they know it's, like, not in the bar.
Yeah. So as they arrive at the party, Marge is sure that she can find some sort of hint to Dylan's identity. She finds several female-identifying folks having a tea party as the overture to Sleeping Beauty plays. So to Marge, that clearly indicates that Dylan is obviously a girl. But on the other side of the yard, there are several kids dressed as superheroes from DC, Marvel, and others, cheering as a kid dressed as Superman is about to beat up a kid dressed as Batman.
Is this the Simpsons did it? This is before the Batman v Superman Dawn of Justice Zack Snyder movie, right?
That's true. Yeah, they predicted this.
Simpsons did it again. I'm looking at the superheroes real quick.
Yeah.
So obviously Superman, Batman, I see Spider-Man, Fallout Boy, Radioactive Man. Is that Captain Underpants there too? That's like a...
Yeah, which is not really a superhero, more of a literary character, but still.
There's a Hulk, Doc Ock, there's a football boy, just has a football helmet and a cape.
Yeah, I tried to look up like superhero with football helmet, and it's just a lot of football helmets with like Superman on them.
At first I saw Captain Underpants, and I almost thought it was, what was Doug Funny's superhero? Quail Man, yeah.
I don't like how quickly I could pull that up. My brain.
Well, I remember I saw recently on Disney Plus, they had Doug. I'm like, I'm just going to turn it on. But it was newer ones that when they stopped doing Nickelodeon, they went to ABC/Disney, and the animation's a little different. Yeah, not my Doug, all right?
No. That Doug is from 2001, not 1998.
Yeah. That Doug Funny, more like Doug Unfunny.
Oh, Patty Mayonnaise, more like Patty Miracle Whip.
Roger Plotz, more like Roger Putz.
Hey.
Okay. That's a fun superhero party. Just really fun. The parents aren't intervening. This kid about to like hit him like in the back of the head too with a cape. And I'm just staring at the image. It's very funny to me.
It is.
Anyway, so Marge wonders what kind of party has two activities, right? Thinking they're just trying to confuse her. A woman mentions that Dylan's best friend has arrived. And when Marge sees that it's just a shaggy dog, she just gives up. It was weird editing, too, because when she said Dylan's best friend has arrived, they do a cut right to Bart's face with a smile. It's like, right when I'm like, wait, are they assuming? I'm like, oh, no, it's just a dog.
Yeah, it was.
But also at a young age, I think. Now, I guess this is kind of the age where you're only friends with the same gender. But, you know, like in like preschool, kindergarten,
right,
age,
it doesn't
really
matter. You don't think about
it. Yeah.
Nowadays, it's probably a lot more acceptable to be like friends with somebody of the opposite gender anyway.
Yeah. And I kind of have hope for this new generation of kids, like not the Gen Zers, but like the kids that are like kids now, you know?
Gen Alpha.
Yeah. Because I was listening to a podcast and they were talking about, I forget what it was, can't credit it, but they were talking about how a lot of little kids nowadays aren't all about like social media and cell phones and devices. They kind of want to like live off the grid because they see their parents doing this. And like, that's not cool. I don't want to do that. So it gives me hope that maybe we'll move past this internet age and kids will start like going out again and doing drugs and playgrounds, not posting on Snapchat. That's all I'm hoping for.
Yeah, I like that. That sounds promising.
Marge, like I said, she gives up and she grabs her gift for the guest of honor, hoping Dylan likes trucks. As she says this, a woman speaks up behind her saying, "Lady, don't know Dylan." And then Bart finds some cupcakes, takes a bite of one, and he's disgusted when he learns that it's carrot cake. So he spits the cake out of his mouth, puts it back in the muffin liner, shaping it to its original form. So he puts it back on the plate where another boy finds it, and then happily takes a bite, saying, moist. And Bart then discovers a group of boys sitting in a circle playing some sort of card game.
Oh, carrot cake! So moist! Battle card, digitate!
Defense card, deflecto warp!
Dishiwaki, goji kick!
Hey, Dinks, what you dweebin'?
You don't know Battle Balls?
It's a Japanese card game based on a cartoon, based on an ancient religion, based on a candy bar.
It makes Digimon look like Pokemon.
What? Impossible!
I like how Bart doesn't like the carrot cake, and then immediately it's Nancy doing a different voice. This just sounds kind of like Bart.
Oh, carrot cake. Delicious.
It is.
It is. I like that kid.
We're going to call him the Carrot Cake Kid. All K's.
Yes, because a triple K
kid.
Liking delicious desserts that are vegetable in nature, he also is a white supremacist. Kid's got layers. Well, speaking of those battle balls, one kid flicks his battle ball onto his card. It opens up and erects a corkscrew that impales its opponent and pulls out its microchip. The other, bird-shaped battle ball, screams in pain, then lets out a claw from one of its wings and stabs itself in the head, ending its misery. Lebatoy that commits suicide. The winning battle ball does a victory dance, which impresses Bart.
Are you glad you didn't grow up in the age of, like, this as a toy?
Yeah. So, obviously, this is a take on, like, Bakun Ball, which is a take on, like, Digimon, which is a take on Pokemon and, like, others, Digimon, which I think that we're both probably too old for. And, yeah, I'm glad because I never got it. I had nephews who liked this kind of stuff, and it looked interesting, but it never, like, appealed to me.
Yeah, you know what? I think the reason why we are who we are is because toys, for us, wasn't a group thing. Like, we got action figures. And yes, you could play action figures with your friends, but your friends never did it right. They didn't do it the way you wanted to do it.
Right.
So we had board games, but then that becomes like you got to set things up and, you know, it's a hassle when you're a kid. You just want to get straight to the action as a kid. So you had action figures. And, you know, you'd go to your friend's house and they show you theirs and you show them yours. But you just wanted to go home and play with alone. Your own. Like, yes. So maybe that's why we're such introverts, is because toys were just action figures when we were kids.
I think you're right, because we did have our own narrative, because we'd watch, like, the cartoon based on those action figures. And we take that information and our own kind of imaginations and build our own story. And so we didn't need other people. We didn't need friends, because I had Lion-O and, you know, Duke to fight Mumm-Ra and Cobra Commander. And so who needs friends?
Yeah, because there'd be like some friends that would, like, if you had Star Wars toys, it'd be like, okay, we're going to play Star Wars. And they're like doing the whole movie. I'm like, what the fuck are you doing? Like, I know what this movie is. Like, no, I'm taking Luke and Han, and they're going to go and fucking kick Shredder's ass. They're not going to fight Vader. Yeah.
We've already seen that story. Like, we know how that ends. And so I want to see how they fare against the fly guy.
Jeff Goldblum.
Exactly.
Did you ever, like, borrow toys from kids?
I feel like I lent out toys to kids.
Yeah. I mean, I specifically remember, like, you lending me your PS1 back in the day. Mm-hmm. And that was cool.
Well, that's one thing. But I feel like action figures are a bit more private. I don't know why.
Yeah. I'm assuming when you lent me your PS1, it was like right when you discovered masturbation. So you're just like, yeah, fine, let's take it. I got other things to do this weekend.
Exactly. Tony Hawk can't help me here.
Yeah, your Lara Croft was a little hard to open up, though.
I love triangles. Big, juicy triangles.
Well, see, let's go to the other side of the town where Homer arrives at the First Bank of Springfield, or the BS Bank. Whilst enjoying a candy apple on a stick, which, if I'm going to choose those treats that we've seen already, I'm taking the carrot cake over a candy apple any day.
Absolutely.
So he sees a sign that reads, "No food allowed in bank." And he tells his little sweet red friend to lie low, having one more bite before hiding the carnival treat inside his jacket pocket. Now, I keep thinking of what's going to happen here, Steve. So he steps inside the bank with his sweet snack as the mistaken for, of course, a gun. The last bite have may have been a mistake, as his mouth is sticky from the apple's candy coating. So let's hear a clip.
He's got a gun!
I think he's saying he'll kill one hostage an hour until he gets what he wants.
He's saying he wants $1 million in unmarked bills.
Oh, that's pretty nice.
It's just a candy apple.
Clearly he's saying wants to be tasered again.
Get him deep in the meat.
Homer Simpson, for causing a panic in the bank, you are hereby sentenced to 100 hours of community service.
Community service? But that's work. What about jail?
Community service!
No, I want to go to jail! Free food, teardrop tattoos, library books that come to you! I'll serve anything but the community!
I love the guard just to be like,
yeah,
I think he's got a gun. I think he wants to be tasered more.
As like his moment of reasoning, like, I would like $1 million in unmarked bills. That would be nice.
I think I'm going to take community service over jail time. Sorry.
Oh, yeah, 100%. As I've discussed, prison is one of my biggest fears. I don't like men, and I don't like being locked up with men. That just sounds like the worst thing ever.
I'm going to cross off what I'm giving you at the end of the episode as your gift.
Unless it was just library books coming to me, I'm not going to.
And the time.
Yeah, of course. So that was Dane Kazmarek playing Constant Harm. It's her eighth time as that role in a speaking role. She'll appear two more times as of this recording. Once in season 31's Todd, Todd, Why Hast Thou Forsaken Us, our 184th episode. And in season 34's One Angry Lisa, which we covered in our 192nd episode.
Yeah, that was her triumphant return in season 34. Well, Homer shows up in an orange vest at a filthy park to complete his community service with other scofflaws. Kearney, Herman, Kent Brockman, and a nearby cop car. Chief Wiggum tells his wife that his community service detail should end around 5 o'clock and invites her for dinner at that seafood place. And then as Krusty and Mr. Teeny arrive to do their time, Sarah tells Clancy that she's got her book club again. Wiggum comments that that thing sure means a lot. And mentions that he's read the book and they're talking about, so maybe he could come. And before he can finish, she reminds him that there wouldn't be enough chairs. He then tells his wife that he'll probably be asleep in front of the fridge when she gets home. Now, is this like the first time and only time that like there's a problem with the Wiggums?
I mean, I think that in newer episodes, we had like that kind of backstory about Sarah Wiggum when she's played by Megan Mullally. As she has a bit more independence and maybe is not so patient with old Clancy. But in this time, yeah, it's a little weird. And I'm going to talk about this a little later in the episode, but I think that she's really missing out on something great.
Wasn't she she's like an international criminal or something like that? I forget that episode. Yeah. There's something like that, yeah.
Yeah.
I think they've now decided to flesh out that character. But this is kind of sad, you know?
It is. It's a bummer because, you know, ACAB, but still, it's sad when relationships are one-sided and no work out.
She's the originator of the ACAB slogan.
Mm-hmm. All Clancy's are bastards.
Yeah.
So, Wiggum steps out of his squad car to face those who have been assigned community service, saying that they make him sick. He then notices Homer's lunchbox and asks what he's packing. Homer says that it's just his lunch, which consists of
chicken parm,
meatball parm,
eggplant parm,
shish kebab,
angel food parm,
and mugu gai parm.
Which one are you going to try?
Oh boy. I kind of curious about the shish kebab.
I'm curious about the angel food parm.
Yeah, that one is either going to be good or gross. Because I've had chicken parm and I've had eggplant parm. I feel like meatball parm is basically just a meatball sub.
Right. That's what I assume as well.
Yeah, the shish kebab could have like a nice little like Middle Eastern flair, and the mugu gai parm might be a little, you know, a little soy based or something. Could be good.
But what would be an angel food parm? Like, so angel food's the bread, but then what's inside the bread? Like, what's the sandwich?
Here's a weird thing. Maybe it is a dessert, but with some cheese, like, because Parmesan isn't like super tangy or anything. It's kind of a mild cheese flavor. Very. So I think you could put it into a dessert. Kind of like a panna cotta or a mascarpone.
I think you could definitely parm an apple.
Mm-hmm. I'd parm an apple.
Steve, you're married.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Maybe some.
Don't say that.
Maybe some berries.
Okay. I'm just a little upset that the sandwiches aren't wrapped into, plastic or something to keep them fresh and not touching each other.
That's true, and they're really stuffed in there, too.
Yeah. So not plastic, maybe some butcher paper or something that's better for the environment. I apologize to all of our environmentalists out there.
Yeah, yeah. So maybe some recyclable parchment paper or something.
Yeah. Homer says that his wife can parm anything. And Wiggum sadly states that his wife only parms on his birthday. So we're getting definitely a blowjob joke here.
Mm-hmm. Or anal sex.
Or just even normal sex. Maybe Wiggum.
Yeah.
Maybe that's why that's the setup for this whole episode is like, just assume that Wiggum's having issues this way. They can have this blowjob joke. I don't know.
But again, I'm going to get to it later, but I really think Sarah's missing out.
Okay, well, I'm going to cut what you say out of this podcast anyway.
Fair enough.
Okay. Wiggum's giving Homer this sad puppy dog look, and it's very sad and pathetic. So Homer takes pity on that, on Wiggum, and offers him a bite. Clancy takes an eager bite, then assigns the job to the wrongdoers. That bite looks like it's like more like a panini, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Well, let's hear a clip, all right?
Okay.
Okay, criminals.
Here's your assignments. Brockman, you get the used condoms out of that thorn bush. Krestovsky, go sort those bums by the war they were in. And Simpson, you sit down at this picnic table here and grab a bite with me.
Teacher's pet.
Hey, find your nose, funny man.
There was cocaine in there. I won't last an hour.
Do you ever wear your police pants to regular things?
Throw a jean jacket on top of these babies and you can go anywhere.
From fast food to fine dining?
And everything in between. Ugh. Ever stop breathing when you're asleep?
Oh, yeah, all the time. They say it's because I'm overweight.
Overweight? You? Oh, now, that's crazy. Now, me? I have to get my underwear specially made by this village in the Ukraine. They call me Daddy Round Round. Send me a Christmas card every year.
That's some big underwear.
My underpants paid for their water filtration system.
And sadly, of this record, that village in Ukraine is no longer there. Jeez. What? Too soon?
I mean, too long, honestly. It's been going on for a long time. But
yeah, it really has. At least that's the only conflict that America cares about, right?
Exactly.
Jesus. Okay. Another podcast.
On a lighter note, let's look at the homeless people. One of them looks an awful like John Swartzwelder.
Is that where he is now?
Probably, yeah. It's just in some dirty park, smoking cigarettes.
Talking about the wars they were all in.
Yeah.
He fought bravely in the Cola Wars, Schwarzwelder yeah. did.
He represented RC.
RC is the best cola with cigarettes in a diner booth.
I think, you know, it was my mom's era cola, so I think you're going to be exactly right. Because she also loves cigarettes in diner booths, so in all tracks. Chief Wiggum sends the community service crew home, but not before stopping Homer to nervously ask if he'd like to get a beer sometime. Homer agrees, wondering if Clancy's ever been to Moe's. So Clancy answers with a sarcastic "Earth to Homer," reminding him that he was arrested there last month. Homer apologizes for being a jerk, but Wiggum totally understands. After all, his sports team lost. Clancy plans to see Homer at Moe's, and Homer tells him that he's there every day from 5 to 11.
Eddie and Lou witness the scene of a budding comradeship and uses the radio to call all units to inform them that their chief just made a friend. Clancy denies it at first, but can't contain his excitement.
He's not my friend. He's just a non-violent perp I'm going to pound a few beers with. Is he looking at me right now? No, don't be so obvious. Let's all look without looking, okay? Oh, my God, he likes me. Officer up! Officer way up!
Now, I know they're, like, going for a parody of, like, you know, when you're young and in love, and, like, does this person like me? Oh, they do, right?
Mm-hmm.
But there's also this kind of works as an adult in a sense of, like, who after the age of, I want to say, honestly, like, 30 maybe, makes a new friend. And when you do, like, make a new friend after, like, a certain age, it is kind of similar to this. Like, really? You want to hang out with me? Well, I have, like, 40 years of baggage you get to learn about. Okay, I guess
exactly,
we can
yeah.
friends. So it's it's very weird to start a new friendship at, like, a certain age. And yeah. I think maybe it is after, like, 35, I would say. 35, is that? What's the age cutoff of, like, because we made friends in our late 20s and early 30s. Like, yeah. acquaintances. Like, what's the last age you think you made an acquaintance at?
So luckily, I made a nice little friendship with a couple probably in the past, like, 4 years. But that's a rare thing. And mm-hmm. they were customers at work, and now they're very close friends of mine. But aside from that, honestly, probably, like, late 20s, honestly. Like, for myself.
Yeah.
You know? And even then, they were more, like, friends of friends, and I hung out with them as a group.
Oh, your wife doesn't count, by the way.
Yeah, exactly. Like, if that was the case, then, yeah, I met my best friend when I was 29.
So it's interesting where this, like, story is kind of going of, like, also very weird after, like, 21 seasons, like, this idea hasn't been mined.
Mm-hmm.
It's just weird that these two pairings, I know they're both overweight men who love food, and, like, there, that's how they can connect. But honestly, that's how you make friends. Like, you go to, like, a festival, right?
Mm-hmm.
Of something similar. You're like, oh, you like this thing too? Duh, that's why you're here. So I I'm fine with what's going on so far, right?
Yeah, and it's kind of cool because you figure, like, Ralph and Bart became kind of friends at one point, and, you know, Ralph dated Lisa. And so they all have, like, you know, Ralph has funny connections to the Simpsons, so it's nice that Clancy's finally joining the gang.
Right. Well, at Cora's Diner, which it isn't retro, Steve, it's just old, Homer is impressed. He can't believe that he's having breakfast at the same place as the cops do. Now, Clancy adds that you can feel good about eating this food, since all the cooks are ex-cons getting a second chance. And then we go to the kitchen, where we see one such former criminal sneezing into scrambled eggs, while another rubs his armpits with toast, and a third ex-con fingers his ear before grabbing a flapjack.
Yep, yum.
I don't think these cooks would be doing that to, like, normal people, just cops.
Yeah, I think you're right. Because, you know, ex-cons would make great cooks, so why not? And so, yeah, I think that they're just kind of getting the revenge.
I think if, like, you know, this whole wake of, you know, ACAB and not a lot of people trusting the police force, I don't think I would be wearing my uniform going into a restaurant. I'd be more afraid of them doing what that is. You know, I don't want these people to know, because I'm afraid that I'd be eating boogers and cum, right?
Exactly. Boogers and cum.
That's a South Park reference, so.
Ah.
Not my original idea, Steve.
I mean, we've all thought about boogers and cum, sometimes multiple times a day. So as Wiggum and Homer finish their breakfast, Homer realizes that he's lost track of time. He's sure that he's going to be late for work, but Clancy says, don't worry, you won't be late. So he tells Homer to follow him, and Homer trails behind the cop car with its lights flashing and sirens blaring. Homer finally knows what it's like to be a pregnant lady. Meanwhile, over at Springfield Elementary, Nelson asks Bart if he has all the best Battle Ball cards. He then tells him to stink again, Smellwad, informing him that Ralph Wiggum has a platinum lava genie.
How'd a pull-up like you get a great card like that?
My not-dead grandma sent it from Tokyo.
Ralph, I will play you for that card.
Okay, but if I win, you have to teach me how to play this game.
Deal. Sir, I think something's going down. Something big.
Could that be some sort of narcotics transaction?
What are you asking me for?
I see you're impressed by my costume for the school's annual drug awareness assembly.
So am I getting a raise or not?
No.
I like Skinner.
So, yeah, Skinner's just kind of dressed as a hypodermic needle. Something that, I don't know that Otto was into heroin.
You know, we all experiment from time to time when you're 25 or 50.
Whatever age he is, yeah.
Yeah.
Do you almost think that, like, oh, it makes sense that Bart, like, I feel like they're Bart setting up with Ralph. Like, are the two stories going to intertwine? And I'm a little disappointed that, like, there's a story there with Bart and Ralph, but like you said already, they already had the Bart and Ralph friendship, so I guess they wouldn't need that.
But that would be a fun parallel to do, you're right. Yeah. Because that could be like whatever happens between Ralph and Bart, like maybe Ralph is like just preternaturally good at Battle Ball, and so Bart befriends him. Like that's one way you could go.
Because in this episode, Homer is kind of annoyed with Clancy, so then reverse it where Ralph gets kind of annoyed with Bart.
And right, then, right, exactly.
In the end, they intertwine or whatever. Yeah. But I'm glad that this is just kind of the scene. Because it's interesting where the B story kind of goes.
It's interesting.
Yeah. So, well, on a ride-along, Homer hands Clancy his coffee, and Homer asks if he wants any sugar. But Wiggum's got it covered. Removing the lid from the coffee cup, opening the sugar packet with his teeth, dumping the packet in the cup while it's still in his mouth, and then stirring the coffee with his ginormous tongue. Mm-hmm. And, well, keeping a hand on a steering wheel. Wait, I think I know where Steve's going with his theory about Sarah Wiggum. Okay. Anyways, Homer is impressed. As they drive, Homer asks if he could run a make on himself, and Homer pulls up his file along with his mugshot and his details. There's a list of criminal activities such as...
We'll start with cable theft, which is obviously from Lisa versus the Eighth Commandment.
Strangling a minor, which is like every other episode of The Simpsons.
Public nudity, which is the one...
Every other episode of The Simpsons.
Exactly.
Unlicensed snowplow.
And then we have impersonating an otter, which isn't actually... I couldn't find. But weirdly, in season 35, this season that we're currently in, there's that weird episode where Marge doesn't want Bart to grow up, mid-childhood's nice dream, and Homer's an otter.
So that could be... it just shows how fluid... time is with this show. expired social security number. I didn't know that happened. Steve, I better go renew mine.
Check your number. We have bear baiting.
Lifeguard taunting.
Barbecuing on a highway median.
And burning man bra in public. Or is it a man's ear?
I like the bro. And being drunk and disorderly, which Homer finds to be a little redundant. Homer asks if he can do a little spring cleaning on his permanent record, and Clancy offers to look away while Homer presses Control F3 on the computer. Homer mistypes, putting himself on Amber Alert. A digital billboard posts a mugshot of Homer saying that he's violent and deranged, and instructs the public to report him to the police. So people begin to notice that Homer's in the squad car, so Clancy thinks fast, changing the billboard photo to Mo Sizzlex, who just so happens to be walking down the street carrying a large wedding cake. Which, I don't get that joke. Because Mo says, oh man, this is a bad time to be carrying this cake.
I'm assuming it's because they're all going to attack him and the cake's just going to fly everywhere and be damaged and he's going to be out of the cake.
Yeah.
What do you think?
Well, I wasn't sure if it was like a candy pedophile situation, like he's going to lure kids with the cake, or if he had some sort of erection that he was using the cake to hide. I didn't know.
I'm just going to go with the cake's going to be ruined.
That makes sense. I guess you're right.
Clancy nervously invites Homer to see his favorite place in the world, and Homer is touched. And Wiggum lets him in a little secret. Cops don't have many friends. He goes on to say that civilians are, and rightfully, scared of the police. And other cops just remind them of things they like to forget. Again, it's like a whole, if you're a cop and you're in public, people aren't going to be nice to you. Or not that they're going to be nice, they're going to be nervous about you. So that's why.
Yeah.
I, for one, am looking forward to the day when we just have android police officers.
I like it.
How about a cop that's a robot, Steve?
Yeah.
thus, Homer's friendship is extra special to Clancy. So Homer tearfully says that it's special to him as well. In the back of a cop car, Snake Jailbird reminds him that he's been back there for like 10 hours and would like to get a bathroom break at least. So Clancy tells them that he's going to be charged with burglary and killing a moment. I think my punch-up was Clancy should have said, but all right, that's you're charged for two manslaughters. One Hans Moment and one this moment. Something like that.
That's a good punch-up. I like that joke.
Meanwhile, at Springfield Elementary, Principal Skinner and Super Nintendo Chalmers have a very serious conversation with Midge.
Mrs. Simpson, Bart has always been what we educators term a no-good Nick, but lately his behavior has taken a more sinister turn.
Yes, we have reason to believe your son has been dealing drugs.
Dealing drugs? That's impossible! He doesn't have the math skills.
Marge, I know you've tried everything to keep Bart under control. Ritalin, lithium, Zoloft. Well, they didn't work. He has moved on to drugs.
Bart? Bart, are you here?
You really know how to roll him, Bart.
That's drug talk. But I could be mistaken. Let me just listen to a little more, out of context.
This product is unbelievable.
It's imported, you know.
Chalmers is talking about, we've tried all of these drugs, but now he's doing drugs.
Yeah, which is also a nice callback to Brother's Little Helper. And yeah, I just like Marge like hearing them and just inhaling so deeply that she chokes on one of Maggie's blocks.
My favorite jokes, and I've said before, is like misdirection and hearing what you want to hear, like Marge assumes drugs, but like everything works in drug context. Very funny.
Yeah, really good. I like that a lot.
But like educators call them no good nicks. Like, I don't think that's a proper term, but
no.
No good nicks.
Also, Marge is reasoning that Bart couldn't possibly be a drug dealer because he doesn't have the math skills. That's very funny to me.
That is very good. Yeah. That's, I think, why I'd be a horrible drug dealer.
Yeah, like, you gotta figure out, like, change and,
yeah,
I just don't want to hang out with drug people. I like drugs, but people, yeah. So Clancy takes Homer to a cliff overlooking all of Springfield. As they sip their Buzz Colas through straws, Wiggum asks if Homer ever worries that the sun's not to come back after it goes down at night. Homer says no, he doesn't worry about that. And Clancy adds that he doesn't either, but you know who does? His son, Ralph.
You know what's funny is, like, when Clancy says that to, like, Homer's like, no, I'm a grown man. Yeah. What are you talking? Like, that look of like, I'm a little worried that we have, I'm friends with you. And, but it's also funny because like, maybe he's thinking like, I know your son is a little slow, but are you also a little?
Yeah. Like, the run of the family.
Yeah. Which does it? Because like sometimes, yeah, he's dumb, but you know, we know he reads a book because he read that book that Sarah Wiggum read.
That's true. Yeah. And he does spend a lot of time explaining things to Ralph that they're not things. So I think that Clancy's got more going on in his head than just that massive tongue of his.
Right. His huge hog tongue.
Yeah.
I've heard of hog tied before. So like hog tied, like tongue tied, hog tied. You know what I'm saying?
You're there. Clancy says that his kid has a lot of worries, such as, what if the bed wets him? Or what if Superman decided to kill everybody? And I gotta say, that's a fairly reasonable fear. Like, Superman could kill everybody.
Also, like, for Marvel Comics, the what if, like, they're running out of ideas of what if is, what if the bed wets him?
I mean, there was that horror movie in the 70s that's all about a bed that kills people, so a bed peeing.
Does
that's far-fetched.
Does Aquaman sleep on a waterbed? Did I just blow your mind up?
I think you did, yeah. Of course he sleeps on a waterbed.
So Aquaman's like the only guy in the world that still has a waterbed.
Yeah. Of course, he just calls it a bed, but...
Yeah. Hey, Aquaman, the 90s are over.
Yeah.
Or, yeah. Like 70s, 80s, and 90s were like prime waterbed time.
Yeah. Ah, man, waterbeds suck.
They're fine for like a single person, but two people, you can't do two people, but my parents did. I don't know. It's just like anytime you move over,
right,
you're going to affect that one person.
I feel like my marriage would end if we had a waterbed.
Yeah, same here. I think we should have lava beds. What do you think about that?
Once the event cold lava, I'm down.
Cold lava.
Homer laughs, saying that Ralph is a good kid and he's got a great dad. Wiggum blushes, telling Homer that he always knows the perfect thing to say.
Well, just then, Lou sends an alert to the radio. So frustrated, Clancy asks what he needs, and Lou says he's being shot and they need backup now. Wiggum rolls his eyes and makes that blah, blah, blah gesture with his hands. He asks Lou if he needs backup or if he wants backup, and Lou urgently states that they've got a 211 in progress, but Clancy told him not to use numbers. So there's another like case of like Clancy, is he dumb? You know, like he didn't learn like the codes that all officers should know.
Right.
Anyway, Lou yells that it's an armed robbery, and then gunshots ring out over the radio. Clancy tells Homer they should probably go. So they arrive outside the underage dungeon and baseball card shop, where Eddie and Lou have Fat Tony and his gang against the wall at gunpoint. And Homer wants to be involved, and Clancy is happily to oblige. But the other cops aren't so sure.
Ooh, ooh, can I cuff him?
Sure, why not?
Chief, come on, he's not trained.
Oh, who are you, the rules police?
No, we are the police. Nobody moves or the doughboy gets popped.
Take your hands off my brother from another mother.
Let's get out of here.
Not to worry, Homer. That's what bulletproof vests are for.
Is the brother from another line a joke gel line?
I think now it is. But in 2010, maybe not so much, but it's getting there, I think.
Yeah, this last week's episode, they kind of had that same joke from the new season when the Italian kid says something like, my brother from another Mamma Mia or something like that.
Right.
All right, we should have joke gelled that last week. We're sorry.
I think so, yeah. That's an omission on our part, so yeah, we're very sorry.
We'll send Steve to real jail for that. Is that okay, folks?
Yeah. I'll turn it into joke jail with all my funny quips, which I'm sure the other prisoners will
love. Yeah.
I'm going to die. So, speaking of dying, Clancy, who just got shot, looks to the back of his squad car and sees his bulletproof vest, fresh from the dry cleaners, still in its plastic. He falls to the ground in pain as blood begins to seep from his unprotected chest. And that's our episode.
That's right. Wiggum's dead. Let's take a break, come back, and finish up this week's episode. How about that?
We'll be right back. Later, at Springfield General Hospital, Sarah and Ralph Wiggum, along with Homer, surround Clancy as he lays unconscious. When Homer asks if he'll be okay, Dr. Hibbert says that it'll be touch and go, adding that his left lung was filled with shamrock shake, And McDonald's didn't even sell them that year.
There's a few years where they don't do it, right? Or like, it was the McRib that they sometimes don't do.
I think both of them. I think the Shamrock Shake especially took a hiatus and then it came back triumphantly.
Because it's just a vanilla shake Diet Green, right?
Yes. I feel like some people say that they can taste mint, but I don't think I ever could.
You know, I'll be honest. I don't think I've ever had a Shamrock Shake.
It's been a long time. I did try the Grimace milkshake that came out earlier last year, and that was pretty good.
Yeah, that was just boogers and cum.
Yeah, but it was still pretty good.
Yeah.
It was Grimace booger and cum. And so, you know, it's taste.
I mean, I think at this point, when Wiggum, this is way back when he talked about, like, wearing a suit jacket, or Homer's, like, the suit jacket with the police uniform, where he's like, Homer says, like, you go from, like, fast food to fine dining. At this point, with the prices, Steve, fine dining and fast food, it's the same. As I was saying, because, like, I had McDonald's, like, a few weeks ago, and, man, like, just, like, two QPCs and, like, a fry was, like, and, like, a chicken sandwich was, like, $25.
Yeah, it's crazy.
And that wasn't, like, DoorDash or anything. That was, like, drive-through. That was the actual ordering in person.
That's what kills me is, like, every now and then, like, especially when I used to drink more, I would get crazy and I'd order fast food, and I would know that I was paying $25 for one meal for myself, and that's just my idiot tax. Like, I get it, and that's acceptable. But then sometimes we'll go to drive-through, and it's basically the same price.
Yeah.
And, like, it's like, I'm not paying somebody to deliver this. This is me. I'm doing the work. I mean, McDonald's people are doing the work, but I'm picking it up. I'm paying for it on site, and it's still quite expensive.
Yeah, exactly. Well, Sarah cries, but Homer comforts her, saying that Clancy was there for him and that he'll be there for Clancy. So Homer sleeps in the chair next to Wickham's hospital bed and reads him the Krusty Burger menu, which I didn't know they had a fold-out menu.
Mm-hmm.
He plays cards with him and cheats a little bit. So what game are they playing? Is he just, like, throws down an ace? Like, is it poker or?
I don't know.
And why does he get rid of an ace? Like, keep ace that ace.
Anyway. Always good.
Yeah. And he shows him a get-well postcard from his underpants-making friends in Ukraine, who wishes Daddy Round the best. Homer watches old episodes of Krusty with the knocked-out Clancy cracking up at the clown in a coconut bra. So laughing so hard, he pushes Wiggum out of bed, but after some time passes, Homer begs Wiggum to wake up.
Don't die on me, Clancy. You said our friendship was special. Well, if it was so special, wake up, you fat sack of...
Homer? What happened to me?
You saved my life, and I came here every day to make sure you pulled through.
Thanks, Homer. You're a true friend. Unlike that Lou. You're too late.
Chief, I've been sleeping on that couch for a week.
You missed the wake-up. That's all that counts.
Ugh.
Clancy, I haven't seen my family in days. Would you mind if I went home now?
Now? But I just woke up.
Well, if you really want me to stay.
No, you do what you have to do. Live your life, which I saved.
Fine, I'll stay a little more.
Great. And can you read me a story that you write yourself? It should be about an imaginary meeting between Babe Ruth and Hitler. But make no mention of baseball or Germany. And begin.
Do we have to do the ChatGPT, make us a story about this, just Steve?
I was just hoping that you would tell me the story, but...
I did.
Okay.
All right. Here we go. Gonna put in the prompt. I mean, I did when I watched this episode, but I didn't save it, which, you know, I should have, but
yeah.
We're gonna get a whole new story here. Write me a short story so we don't have to read a whole long one on this podcast. Short story about Babe Ruth meeting Hitler. Sorry, Adolf Hitler. Don't want to confuse him for it.
Right.
Clark Hitler.
Mm-hmm.
Babe Ruth meeting Adolf Hitler, but they don't mention baseball or Germany. Right? Is that correct?
Yes.
All right, here we go. In the dimly lit speakeasy of 1920s New York, a hush fell over the room as two unlikely figures strode through the door. Babe Ruth, the towering titan of the baseball world, and Adolf Hitler, a charismatic yet enigmatic artist, found themselves in an unexpected encounter. Their eyes met across the smoky haze. each recognizing something familiar yet foreign in the other. Ruth, known for his towering home runs and larger-than-life persona, felt a sense of unease in the presence of Hitler, whose piercing gaze seemed to hold secrets untold. Whoa. Quite the crowd tonight, Ruth remarked, breaking the tension with a disarming smile. Hitler nodded curtly, his gaze wandering around the room before settling back on Ruth. Indeed, it seems the allure of the forbidden is irresistible to Mammy. As the night unfolded, conversation flowed freely, weaving through topics ranging from art and literature to philosophy and politics. Ruth, surprisingly well-read for a man his stature, found himself intrigued by Hitler's passionate discourse on the human condition. Hitler, in turn, was captivated by Ruth's tales of triumph and adversity, finding a kindred spirit in the pursuit of greatness against all odds. Oof. Hours passed in the blink of an eye, the boundaries of time and space blurred by the meeting of two extraordinary individuals. As they parted ways, each carried with them a newfound respect for the other.
Wow.
Forged in the fires of an unexpected encounter that transcended the confines of history and expectation.
Okay.
Well, wow. Taylor Swift, rewrite that song Love Story about this story. It's a love story.
Wow. Yeah.
ChatGPT seems to be fond of Hitler.
A little bit too fond, I'd say. Yeah. Yikes. That's kind of horrifying.
Okay, I'm going to try another one real quick here.
Okay.
ChatGPT, write a story about Donald Trump and Adolf Hitler meeting. Oh, just one sentence. They made America great again. Oh, boy.
Oh, boy.
Oh, not a political podcast, but apparently ChatGPT is.
Wow, yeah.
All right. What are we talking about, The Simpsons?
Oh, yeah. So,
okay.
Worried that Marge's little guy is getting him all his drugs, she snoops into Bart's room. So after digging through his drawers, she finds a Krusty the Clown Russian nesting doll.
A lot of times when Marge digs through his drawers, she also finds a lot of crusty things.
God.
His underwear, Steve. There's drawers.
Right, right.
He's got the little brown stains on there because he doesn't wipe his ass properly. He's a kid.
Bart, come on.
Yeah.
Wipe your ass.
Ay, caramba. Okay.
So she finds a Krusty the Clown Russian nesting doll. She opens it up to find a smaller Sideshow Mel doll. She opens that up to find an even smaller Mr. Teeny doll. So she opens up that one, and she finds a smaller Scratchy doll, followed by an even smaller Itchy doll. So when she opens that one, she finds a key, which opens a cabinet with Krusty's face on it. And then she opens that up, and she finds yet another Russian nesting doll with Krusty's face on it. Good stuff.
I was hoping there would be a Poochie.
Oh, that'd be fun.
Nesting doll. Yeah. Bart's got a lot of Russian nesting dolls. How many Russian nesting dolls did you have when you were a kid, Steve?
Oh, so many.
I think I had to make one, like, for, like, elementary school, like, an art class.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like we made, but, like, they're made of, like, construction paper.
Right.
Or, you know, yeah. And I just remember my teachers taking them and then putting a lot of white powder, much like Marcy's. Because she discovers a dictionary, Steve. So she opens it to learn that the pages have been glued together and a compartment has been carved inside, holding a plastic bag of said white powder. So she licks her finger, like, you know, how the cops always do that, licks the finger and then takes a taste. And then she starts frantically scratching her tongue, thinking, like, oh, no, that's, like, what do you think at that moment? It's like, oh, no, it's like,
cocaine or...
Cocaine, right? But no, it's literally itching powder. It's very, this is a very funny joke.
Yeah.
Visual joke there. So she uses a box cutter to rip open a teddy bear and then a stuffed dragon toy and a stuffed gorilla toy. And she goes to cut a stuffed rabbit, but she realizes it's an actual real rabbit. Where'd that rabbit come from? Is that a pet?
I don't know where it came from. It's a little weird, yeah.
I mean, I have rabbits in my yard, so maybe it's like Bart just like captured a rabbit and just brought it in.
Mm-hmm.
So Bart walks by to see his torn room and shelves everywhere and this mattress is half on the floor. And he comments how awesome his mom finally made his room look cool. Marge then has a very serious question for her son.
Bart Simpson, are you a druggo?
What? No, not until you raise my allowance.
Well, can you explain what you were doing in the basement with Milhouse?
Getting higher and higher. Scores on Battle Ball.
Hey, that's pretty nifty. Let me try. Oh, my gosh, that's adorable. This one's going on the Christmas tree.
It's no fun if my mom likes them. Come on, toilet. If you can handle Dad, you can handle this.
I love the comment Bart makes of like, no, I'm not using drugs until you raise my allowance.
So both Bart and Marge realize that eventually he might do drugs, but it's just a matter of him getting better at math and getting a little bit more money.
Yeah.
It's really a number.
Well, he pretty much will be doing drugs.
Yeah.
And calling him a druggo is great.
Mm-hmm.
And then the toilet. If you can handle Dad, you can handle this.
Yeah.
Dad dumps.
Dad poops. Every dad poops.
Was your parents ever into something that you liked and they're like, no, I'm not doing this?
That's a good question. See, my dad was into the ball.
I'll just answer.
Stick.
The little hoop thing too, like right around with the stick in the hoop.
Kicking cans. So I don't really think that, like, for me, my parents weren't anything, so I wasn't, but like, I know if my mom would like try and play toys with me, like she'd get it wrong. Like we were talking earlier about, you know, other kids playing like G.I. Joe's wrong. But my mom would like try and be like, and I'm like, no, Destro doesn't beat friends with Flint. That makes no sense. Like, why would they hang out? That kind of thing.
Yeah. I don't remember my parents specifically trying to play with me.
Oh.
Sounds sad, doesn't it? But I remember like my grandma trying to like play like Nintendo with me. It was really kind of funny. There's this like 7-year-old woman trying to figure out how to jump Mario.
Oh yeah.
But yeah, I think it's just so it's like your parents like try to force their likes onto you, so I wasn't trying to find discover. I'm like, why would my dad like, oh, you want to play Ninja Turtles? That sounds fun. No.
Yeah. Grown man. You don't want to play Ninja Turtles. So back at the Simpsons at Moe's, Lenny asks Homer where he's been for the past few weeks. Homer informs his barfly friends that he's been playing nursemaid Chief Wiggum. Carl states that people who get shot in the chest are such big babies. So Homer takes a swig of his Duff, saying that it's so much better than hospital beer. Just then, Clancy, walking with a cane, bursts into the tavern with Eddie and Lou. He's offended to find Homer, and even more offended not to find a certain member of the Brat Pack. Later, back at 742 Evergreen Terrace, everything reminds Homer of Clancy, even an old episode of Starsky and Hutch.
Well, well, well. So this is the St. Elmo's Fire reunion that Andrew McCarthy himself was going to attend.
Okay, maybe I lied, but you've been so needy. I'm hungry. I'm itchy. That's not my blood type.
Yeah. Oh, what have we here? Huh. World's worst friend.
Hey, man, you planted that.
It's your word against the chief of police. Take him away, boys.
Chief, being a bad friend isn't against the law.
Well, if it was, he'd be getting the chair. You all would. Bad friend, bad friend, bad friend.
Who gave me up?
Guess what, Silky? It was your own mother.
How does that feel?
You both jive. You hear me? You both jive.
That doesn't look like Ben Stiller and Owen Wilson.
Yeah, Starsky and Hutch was, I think, before my time. So, I mean, I'm familiar with the concept in the show.
Yeah.
But it wasn't something that was, like, on my TV.
Me neither. Like, I know the show, like you say, I know of the show, but I never, like, really watched it.
I don't think even, like, my parents would have watched it.
It feels a little urban for my dad to enjoy.
Yeah, I was going to say, like, my dad loved the Rockford Files, like Magnum P.I., stuff like that. But I don't think Starsky and Hutch, that's the old 70s, like, cop shows, which we could probably do a whole podcast, like, just on 70s cop TV shows.
Oh,
go
yeah.
For, like, 500 episodes. Not reviewing every episode, just, like, an episode of each.
Right, like McMillan and Wife and, like,
too many, see, too many.
Too many to mention, yeah.
Well, the credits to Starsky and Hutch show that it's a Stephen J. Cobb show production, which we found out last week. Steve's middle name is Earl, and we made a joke of his last name, but this is your actual real last name is Cobb Show.
That's right. Yeah, I'm Stephen Cobb Show.
Homer laments at the loss of his friendship and changes the channel. So he turns to an old mobster movie featured NJ Robertson, which, of course, it reminds him of Wiggum, which is, you know, the inspiration to Wiggum's voice.
Yeah.
Very funny scene. Another channel is a pig's eating slop. Just another reminder. Uh-huh. Marge informs Homer that he has some visitors. It's Eddie and Lou, who haven't seen the chief in days, and they're starting to worry.
Oh, no.
I just should mention that the Stephen Jay cop show was a reference to Stephen Jay Connell, who
right.
did a lot of cop shows.
I still TV have that too. Image of my head of him, like, typing on the typewriter at the end of, like, Murder, She Wrote, and the piece of paper flies up, and then it forms a SCC, like a Stephen yeah. Productions. Yeah. So the cops ask if Homer knows where Clancy might be. He has an idea, but he has to go alone. He then whispers to Marge that his car is filled with stolen printer paper from the power plant, which I don't think the cops would honestly really care, even if he did steal it.
I think everyone who's hosted this podcast or listens to this podcast has probably stolen printer paper from their work.
Yeah, and if you haven't, you've printed something at work that you used for your... That's just like a law.
Yes.
You have to do it.
Right.
So Homer arrives at the cliff overlooking Springfield, where he finds Clancy. Homer brought a 32-piece chicken bucket, but Clancy assumes that Homer brought it all for himself with none to share for him.
I mean, it makes sense, right?
Yeah, totally.
So Homer and Clancy then hear Fat Tony tell his gang that they need to stitch those alligators. They're making knockoff Lacoste shirts to sell at the mall for the crazy days of summer sale. Wiggum tells them to freeze, and Johnny Tightlips tells his crew to be careful since Clancy's weapon is loaded with 12 original herbs and spices. That's right. Clancy is pointing a chicken drumstick at the gangsters. Steve, do you want to... Should we tell people the secret to the KFC original herbs? As according to the internet, I've seen a piece of paper that was originally written by the colonel himself that has this list. So if people want to emulate the herbs, I guess who's gonna kill us, right? Who's going to arrest us for this? All right. Quick rundown here. Everyone, write this down real quick. You're going to need 2/3 of a teaspoon of salt, half a teaspoon of thyme, half a teaspoon of basil, 1/3 of a teaspoon of oregano, 1 teaspoon celery salt, 1 teaspoon of black pepper, 1 teaspoon of dried mustard, 4 teaspoons of paprika, 2 teaspoons of garlic salt, 1 teaspoon of ground ginger, and 3 teaspoons of white pepper. And I think this is the reason why those are the original herbs and spices, because those were the only herbs and spices that were available back then. So,
yeah.
I've actually done this recipe, and it's fine, but I've since then taken this recipe and then put my own ingredients and tweaked some of the spices. So I won't tell you the CFC, which is Craig's Fried Chicken.
Right. I also let's just have say. A seasoning blend for another chicken chain, one that might have a... share a name.
Sailor?
Yeah, who likes his greens. And that one's far better. So, but I'm not going to share that.
Not until they do a Popeye's joke, right?
Exactly.
All right.
So the mobsters all laugh at Clancy, and he tells them that they are chive. Fat Tony and the boys take Homer and Clancy at gunpoint and load them into the trunk of their car, all tied up. Clancy apologizes to Homer, saying that if he hadn't been so needy, they wouldn't be in that trunk. Homer admits that he was ungrateful, especially after Wiggum saved his life. Clancy's just glad that they could be friends again, even before getting whacked. Homer vows that they're not going to get whacked because he's with Chief Clancy Wiggum. He's going to figure a way out of this. Clancy's surprised that Homer has so much faith in him, but Homer states that faith is what you have in things that don't exist, like God, and Wiggum's awesomeness is real.
So Clancy looks over at the CD changer in the truck, and this was a thing, so if...
Oh, yeah.
People might not understand this. Like, when you had a car, you can get a CD changer that had, like, 6 different CDs. But you had to have it in the trunk of your car for some reason. Well, because you couldn't fit it in there. So so he uses his huge hog-tied tongue to use the eject button. So the disc changer pops out, and once again, using his tongue, rearranges the CDs. And then he lifts the changer back with his tongue.
Yeah, so that's basically what I was alluding to, is that, like, if Clancy has that much power with his tongue, then Sarah's really, you know, missing out.
So, I mean, I solved the Steve's thing, so yes. Puts Gene Simmons' tongue to shame, doesn't he?
He does, yes.
Although, Wiggum...
He's less of a worse person.
Yeah, I don't see Chief Wiggum selling Chief Wiggum coffins.
That's true.
Although, I think I'd rather have a Chief Wiggum coffin than a Kiss coffin.
I would also prefer that as well.
I'm sure there's Simpsons-themed coffins out there, and hopefully you and I will get one of these days.
Hopefully sooner than later.
But sadly, we will never know if we do.
That's the problem with coffins. It's like, you spend all the good money on them, but the person doesn't appreciate it.
Here's my thing. I think I want to be in those biodegradable coffins where they supposedly, like, you bury them and then, like, trees grow.
Yeah.
Like, they plant you with, like, a bunch of seeds and shit like that. I want that.
That sounds great. Yeah, I would like, rather, help the environment as I decay.
Like, I want to be a tree in death. Like, I don't want a tombstone. I want a tree. So people go to, like, that's the Craig tree. It'd be cool. It'd have, like, only two nuts. And I have, like, squirrels hanging on my tree. Oh, man.
Oh, you'd love that. Dogs could pee on you whenever they want.
Yeah, I don't have to pay them to do that.
Yeah, teenagers will carve their names in your chest. And maybe somebody sad will hang themselves off your branch.
God, I can only hope. And make sure you put googly eyes on the tree, too. That'll be fun.
Of course.
All right. So in the car, Fat Tony requests some ominous music, which will make their drive to the body dumpery more cinematic. So Louis hits play, but instead of ominous music, Janice Ian's At 17 plays, which I think was like kind of like the alternate Simpsons theme. They play this song a lot.
They do.
Fat Tony knows this tune. It's part of Louis' folk divas mix. So Louis pulls over, gun drawn, ready to slap some sense into that CD changer.
But as Louis opens the trunk, Clancy blasts his face with some white goo, telling him to eat Fix-A-Flat, because it's Fix-A-Flat. Louis screams in agony, and Clancy takes his gun. Fat Tony gets out of the back seat, ready to shoot Wiggum, but Homer hits him with the tire iron. Seeing this, Clancy's relieved that it was a tire iron poking him in the back, rather than Homer's erect penis. Eddie and Lou throw the gangsters in the back of the squad car, and Lou makes one more announcement on the radio.
Attention all units. Chief Wiggum and Homer have moved into a new phase in their friendship. The flame will burn less brightly, perhaps, but this time may last much longer.
Well said, Lou. Homer, you want to take out the police copter and hassle people with the spotlight?
I know just the guy.
Landers, wake up! Take off your clothes and prepare to be raptured!
Oakley dokily!
Now shave off your mustache and drink the hairs in a cup of cocoa!
Hot cocoa?
No! Ice cold!
I think there should have been a line where, after Flanders takes off his clothes, Clancy should have said, "Wow, oh, yeah, that puts my tongue to shame."
Yeah, now that is a power iron.
Well, as the credits roll, Janicean's S-17 plays again. Well, we see stills of Eddie and Lou getting Homer and Clancy in the police helicopter and stuck out of a tree.
Homer and Clancy high-fiving two dead bodies in the morgue.
Homer lifting up Clancy in the ice rink in the style of the 2007 film Blades of Glory, featuring Will Ferrell, John Heder, and an office lady herself, Jennifer Tru.
Homer worrying as a vending machine falls on Clancy.
Clancy dressed as a cowboy and Homer as an old-timey barmaid in a saloon photo shoot.
Homer and Clancy painfully in a vice being tortured by Sideshow Bob.
I want to see that episode.
I know.
And Homer and Clancy looking into each other's eyes as they both suck straws from a roasted turkey, much like you do with milkshakes, but the turkey. Steve, would you ever suck a turkey with me?
I could suck a turkey. Gobble, gobble, suck, suck.
Well, Steve, that's how the episode ends. So I'm thinking we should take a break and suck a turkey and then come back and wrap up this week's episode. How about that?
Sounds great to me.
All right. We'll be right back.
I learned the truth at 17. Their love was meant for beauty queens. In high school, girls with clear-skinned smiles who married young and then retired. The valentines I never knew, the Friday night charades of youth were spent on one more beautiful. At 17, I learned the truth. And those of us with ravaged faces, lacking in the social graces, desperately remained at home.
And we're back. All right, Steve, let's wrap up this week's episode, Chief of Hearts. We'll talk about some of our favorite scenes, some favorite jokes, give it a nice review, find out where we're watching next week. But before we do all that, we like to give a gift, something from this episode that the other host would appreciate. Originally, I was going to give him a nice vacation in jail, but Steve said he doesn't want that. I don't want to be cruel. So instead, I'm going to give him a candied apple.
Ugh.
Okay, fine. You still get the candied apple.
Okay.
But also a Russian nesting doll of The Simpsons.
Yeah, oh, nice.
You get Homer, then Marge. Although you think Marge should be first because of her hair, right?
Right.
But it's not. And also the complete series of Starsky and Hutch on DVD.
Oh, very nice. Oh, well, Craig, I appreciate that. I got you some stuff as well. I got you a carrot cake muffin, which certainly has not been eaten and spitten back out. And then I got
it's very moist.
A lunchbox full of various parms, as well as a giant pair of underpants made by war-torn folks in the Ukraine. They might not be tidy-whities, but they'll do.
I actually appreciate all the food ones. It's great. I might save that angel food parm for last.
That seems a good way to close it out, yeah.
All right, Steve, what from this episode made you go, wah-ha?
Wah-ha.
Any MVJs?
I think Marge, maybe, honestly. I liked her thinking that Bart was a druggo. I liked her assuming that when she heard Bart and Milhouse in the basement that they were doing drugs because Bart rolls well and it was imported product. I also just liked her digging through Bart's room, especially with the box cutter opening up the teddy bear and then the gorilla and then almost the live rabbit. I thought that was fun. I thought that the Homer Wiggum dynamic was fun, but I think that if I have to give an MDJ, I'm going to give it to probably Marge. What about you, Craig?
Yeah, you're right about Marge. That over-concerned parent that she's playing right now. And especially, like, she knows Bart's probably going to go down a dark path when he's a teenager. So for her, it's like, it's already happening. So she's not prepared now to deal with this, even though she knows it's going to happen. Which I think is great. Lisa might be my MVJ in this episode. I thought her lines were great. Solid performance by Yardley.
Mm-hmm.
But also, I'm going to give it to Lou. I feel like Lou was great in this episode. He was also like the not unsung hero, but like there could have been a story with Lou being jealous of Homer. Because I really think that I know they were together, but I feel like Lou has always looked out for Clancy and is kind of like should be his best friend in a way.
Even to your point, he was even supportive when he saw that Clancy had a new friend in Homer because he made the joke over the radio. Hey, buddy, like, look what you're doing. Good for you. Like, he was being a supportive friend even when Clancy wasn't there for him. So, yeah, you're right.
And Lou was in the hospital the same amount of time Homer was, maybe even more.
Right. And he just respected him and gave him some space, but he also bought him flowers. So, yeah.
I think Lou's the unsung hero of this episode.
I respect
that. I just love the Homer going through the TV and then showing all of, like, the iterations of Starsky and Hutch, but also the Edward G. Robinson impersonation. And I just thought the dumbness of Homer walking into a bank with the premise of him just having a candied apple. It's so dumb, but it's just really funny going into a bank and people thinking it's a gun.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of chuckles on that one. What did you think of the episode in general, Steve?
When I was, like, learning about this, the premise of it, I was kind of skeptical because I thought, like, it's kind of like what we kind of call, like, dartboard episode where, like, it's just, what if Homer and Clancy became friends? And it kind of what it was, but I do like that Homer kind of had this kind of emotional arc of, like, befriending him and then kind of, like, feeling that he's needy, and then they kind of worked it out. I liked what Lou said at the end about how their friendship might not burn as bright as it initially did, but it'll last longer and maybe be more powerful because they realize that there's boundaries and that, like, it doesn't have to be all or nothing. I appreciated that. I also like, you know, Marge being genuinely concerned about Bart. All the misdirection, I thought that was a lot of fun. I found this episode to be enjoyable. I know that we talk about this, like, season 18 to 25 being a little bit kind of a low point, but I thought this was fun. I think that it was kind of a light, breezy episode. And, you know, I enjoyed myself. All in all, I think it was a positive experience. I don't have, like, a lot of negative things to say about it. I do think they could have gone some other directions, like we talked about, with the possibility of, like, Bart and Ralph and their friendship. And it's kind of a bummer not to have Lisa, but I, you know, it happens. I think at this point, Homer is the only Simpsons character who's not, who hasn't been excluded from an episode. But all in all, I think it was great. So let's see here. If I had to give this a ranking, a numerical score, if you will. So the game Battle Ball is obviously based on Bakugan, the card and ball game. And some of those are worth money. In fact, all the way up to $18.88, kind of a beanie baby situation where it was oversaturated the market. So if I had to give this score out of 1888, I'm going to give this a 1453, we'll say. What did you think, Craig?
I think you're right about this episode. It's something that we haven't seen yet. Like, why aren't they friends? And they should be. And also, it's established, too, that after this episode, they are friends. I don't like it when the reset button is hit on episodes where it's like, okay, I, you know, there could have been like, well, I guess because you're a civilian and I'm a cop, we can't be friends. But let's just end it here. Reset button back to status quo. So the idea that they're still friends is great. And I think they should be friends. I said that at the beginning of the episode, well, how come this hasn't been done? And then you mentioned like in your review, like, you know, there are certain things that it could have gone, but also I'm glad it went the way it did because we just went to the answer of like, it should have gone this way, but that's because that's what we're expecting.
That's true.
So that's what made this episode great was that it didn't go the way we expected. Because if we were expecting something, then what's the point of watching something, right? Like, well, this is going to happen. Then I'm not having fun if I'm just knowing exactly how it's going to happen. So I'm glad the Ralph and Bart story didn't happen because that's what I was expecting. Excellent. I'm glad that Lou wasn't jealous because that's what I was expecting. So I think this was a lot of fun for me. I feel like the last couple weeks we've been not down, but just a little bit like meh on the Simpsons mid, as I've been saying recently. But this was a lot of fun. And for being that early 20s, 20 of the seasons type of episodes where it's slowly, I think, kind of like finding a different voice. And this one felt definitely in the world, even though there's like silliness going on. This one definitely felt like, no, this could happen. If I gave it a ranking here, let's look at the history of the police in America. So in this country, you know, we were still the colonies. The first city to establish a night watch, which was essentially the first police force, I'm doing air quotes, which was a part-time without pay. So it was like a volunteer service, began in the year 1635. So that's the beginning of policing in America is 1635. So I have 1,635. I'll give this episode a 1,422.
Wow.
Yeah. Still a good score, right?
Yeah, I think so. I think it's a great score.
I enjoy this one. I think it's a rewatch for me. I think you'll find more jokes next time around and fun visual gags. So very fun. Steve, we don't have a new episode for season 35 next week, so we're still going to be spinning that good old wheel to find out what we're watching in the meantime. So let's bust out the old wheel to see what we're watching next week. How about that?
Alrighty, sounds good. Let's give it a spin to see which season we're in.
Boop. Don't.
Steve, we're going to the not too distant future for season 28.
Season 28. Alrighty, let's give it another spin to see which episode we're watching.
Boop. Don't.
Woohoo! Episode 22.
Season 28, episode 22.
Yeah, what do you think this title is?
So season 28, so we're talking like 2016, 2017 probably.
2017, and I'll let you know that it is airing on the day of May 21st. And the production code is WABF15.
Oh, okay then.
Written by Mr. Burns himself, J. Stewart Burns.
Okay. So May, the end of May, that makes me think like kind of around Mother's Day. And you said J. Stewart Burns. I'm going to say the title of this episode is Burn My Daddy, Mommy.
No, not at all. Look.
Okay.
I mean, what? All right. It's one word, Steve, but it sounds like two. It's Dogtown.
Dogtown.
Only one word. Dogtown. Mm. It is the season finale for season 28. Yeah, Dogtown.
Well, when I think of the words dog and town, one, I imagine this wonderful city consisting only of dogs. But also I think of Dogtown and the Z-Boys, which is a documentary about the early skateboarding revolution. So I'm going to say this whole story is about Bart making friends with a bunch of skater kids who Marge thinks are no good nicks. And she gets too worried about him growing up. And it turns out that he's just hanging out with them so he can join a skating competition so he can get his mother a good Mother's Day gift.
Wow. You are so wrong.
Aww.
Yeah. When Homer's court case determines that a dog's life is more valuable than a human is, the statue of man's best friend rises in Springfield. When the dogs recognize their new position of power, they assert their dominance over the humans. Wow, are we doing a, is this a, the hat trick of Homer on trial type of, or?
I think so, yeah.
Another court thing for Homer. Last week we had Homer doing community service. This week also community service. Steve, do you remember this episode at all?
Not in the least. How about you?
Nope.
Okay, well, I'm excited to check it out and to talk about it.
All right, well, hey, everyone, let us know what you think about Chief of Hearts or any other Simpsons things or just whatever. Let us know. Talk to us. We want to hear from you. You can email us at 13simpsons@gmail.com or hit us on social medias of Instagram or YouTube at 13simpsons.
You can always leave us a review on your podcatching app. Leave us 5 stars or the equivalent. But you don't need to write a real review. You can just tell us what drugs you would do if you were a druggo. And hey, while you're there, you can click on the microphone and leave us a voicemail, ask us a question, do an impression, do whatever the hell you want. We want to hear from you.
And check out our TeePublic store, which is tpublic.com/user/annoyedgruntboys for some of our merchandise, like t-shirts and that sort. Thanks again, everyone, for listening. I've been Annoyed Grunt Boy Craig.
And I've been Annoyed Grunt Boy Steve.
And remember, I want $1 million in unmarked bills.
Get them deep in the meat.
There was cocaine in there!